They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat.
For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living.
Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions.
For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me.
For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them.
We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Shall we take the processional hymn, It Is Well With My Soul?
Oh,
Father God, we thank you. We bless you for just who you are. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Shalom, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Almighty. Lord, accept our praise in Jesus' name. Spirit of the living God, we ask that you come and help us, come and comfort us, come and strengthen us. In all we do, let the name of our Lord Jesus be glorified here today. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. The choir will lead us in a session of praise and worship.
Glory be to God in the highest. Amen. Glory be to God in the highest. Amen. For his mercies endure forever. Amen. For his mercies endure forever. Amen. Oh, glory be to God in the highest. Amen. All the glory be to God in the highest. Amen. For his mercies endure. Season.
Mr. Ayomide Oladapo to take the first Bible reading from 1 Corinthians 15 from verse 55 to 58. It's on the second page of our program.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 55 to 58. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, may the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Would like us to please stand for the hymn, first hymn of the service. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder. Please let's rise to take the hymn. Thank you.
Come see the
Amen. Please be seated. Please let's receive Mr. Oluwarotimi Oladapo to help us with the second Bible reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, from verse 13 to 17. It's on page 3 of our program. As we read, let's be blessed. Amen.
First Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to 17. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Thank you very much. We'll take our next hymn, Abide With Me. It's on page 3 of our program. And let's please rise to take the hymn together with the choir.
Oh,
Amen. Please be seated. Pastor Olusegun Oladapo was a man of many parts, and many of us know him. But there's someone that knows him very well, and would like him to come and read the biography of his friend. Please let's receive Dr. Wale Adeyo to please read the biography. Dr. Wale Adeyo. Is he here? Okay. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, I say again. Let's praise the Lord. Say, Lord Jesus, please be with us at these very tremendous times. I have not come to talk about my friend. I have come to have a conversation with everybody about 50 years ago or more. Shay and I collided in the journey of life. We just happened to be in the same classroom, sharing the same walls. He was studying economics, literature, and French. I was studying English literature, history, and economics. We didn't become friends instantly, but after our first term in the college, this was at the Ibadan Grammar School, I distinguished myself, and I therefore had so many enemies in the classroom. Rather from Sheye to join others, Sheye came to me and said, "This man, you got everything right. How did you do it?" I said, "I don't know. I just wrote the exams as everybody did." But we had a teacher, Mr. Ojelabi, who was particularly very good. He was trained in Canada. And Mr. Ojelabi knew history as much as he taught us history itself. So he had placed one of my write-ups on the board in the classroom and said, "Whoever wants to be a good student and wants to pass his higher school certificate should go and look at what Adeyo wrote and try to emulate him." In those days, nobody, not too many people, I will say, passed the HSC, which we call the higher school certificate exam. It was tedious, it was convoluted, it was perplexing, and it was very brief. It was just a two-year tutorial, and they tell you they are preparing you for the university. It was very intensive, but we had good teachers in those days. One of them was Mr. Bode Alalade, who later became a news broadcaster. Mr. Alalade was my English literature teacher. Ojelabi was my history teacher. I wasn't too good in economics, but history and English was mastery for me. So Shaye came and said, "Can you teach me a little thing about literature?" And that's how we became friends. Rather than envy me, like some mothers did in the classroom, Shaye, out of the goodness of his heart, took me as a friend. And that was the end of a long friendship that persisted over the years to last half a century. Not one day did Shaya and I have any kind of reason to fight with each other. Yes, we argue about so many things. That is necessary, and that is normal among people who are very cerebral. And Shaya was indeed very cerebral. And he took his point very seriously, and we let you to know where he stood. You all know where he stood towards the end of his life. He stood with Jesus Christ. How Shaya became a Christian is still a mystery to me, because we did just about everything together. And suddenly, Shaya decided that he was going to give his life to the Lord. He did, very gallantly. And we all thought it was a joke, and that very soon, Shaya will come and join us in the real world. The real world is the world of sin, the world of iniquity, the world of dog eat dog, the world of I don't care. I just must prevail no matter who I step upon to get to the high top. Shaya took life very easy. Way before he became a Christian, I would suppose as soon as he got married to his wife, Adedayo, who was then Miss Egweyemi, now Miss Oladapo. Life is very interesting, and I think I am one of the lucky ones who have actually enjoyed this life in a lot of ways, in the sense that I never have to endure any kind of bereavement in my life, because my father died at 95, and my mother died at about 90. What is my bereavement when my father is 95? What is my bereavement when my mother was 90? But now, I have bereavement. He was not so much my friend as he was my brother. We knew each other very well and understood each other very well. And I got to be a part of his family. I got to be a very close friend of his father, a close friend of his mother, but more a friend of his dad than his mother. He had a brother who was a few years older than us, Bim Oladapo, a person that Shaya called Bros Bim. And that has been his name with me ever since, Bros Bim. Bros Bim took me as much as he took Shaya as a brother, good man, good mentor, very decent human being. Just like the family of Shaya are all decent people. You see, nobility does not ever miss its road. It has a special mission. Nobility goes precisely where he wants to go. He knows the home where he's going to have his residence. And when nobility goes into a particular house, you can see that the seeds of that family have nobility. That was one thing that Shaye had, even from school days in Ibadan, where we were in school. There was a wealthy man around there at that time, still around, at well over 90, Keith Oluakikube. He was supposed to be Shaye's guardian in Ibadan. Professor Akikube too, his brother, was supposed to be Shaye's guardian in Ibadan. Any holiday, Shaye will never go to them. Shaye will come to my own house, sleep in my house, we will eat. But more interesting is the fact that about four houses from my house was Shaye's auntie's house, Mrs. Akikube, Mama Lake. Shaye will not even go to see her one day, because she doesn't want her to say, come and stay here. Shey, would you rather stay with me? And our friendship deepened over the years just because after our adventure at the Badon Grammar School, I had to travel abroad. Shey decided to stay behind to hang around the University of Lagos, which was a very good and prestigious university at that time. I had no doubt about it that she was going to do well in the university. And she had no doubt about me that I was going to do well in the university. We corresponded for a little while, and like most young people, we drifted apart. But when I came to Nigeria, the only person I knew was Shey Oladapo, because he has been my friend for so long. And the moment Shey knew I had arrived in Nigeria, Shey never left where I was. We reunited, and our friendship blossomed. And so we became kindred spirits. We became bonded. We became one. It's impossible for me to tell the story of my life without supporting certain details with Shey's factor. It is impossible for Shey to tell the story of his life without supporting certain significant details without me being present. When he married his wife, Adedayo, in Ibadan, Dayo's wife is somebody I refer to as Mommy. And Mommy called me, Wale, you want me for long more? If you're working fair on dough, I can get. She won't want me for long more. But I'm going to tell you, Mommy. When my mama goes, yeah, no problem, ma. I mean, no problem, but I won't know you. I won't know you. I trust you. This is a special family. Your child is very lucky. Mama, go and rest your mind. And then came the first big bundle of joy, wrote to me, and Mama was excited to have, I believe, our first grandchild. Mama was so enchanted by the fact that she had become a grandmother that she called me and told me, you tell me there'll be no problem. This Yosheye is the father of my grandson. I will love him forever, no matter what he does. So what has he done in the past, ma? Say, nothing. Parents just have the phobia that something will happen. I said, nothing will happen, ma. And life moved on. Then came Ayomide, and later, Morolake. By the time Morolake came, Adedayo was hospitalized at the Yomifini Medical Center at the GRA on Oduduwa Crescent. I was already living on Oduduwa Crescent. I was several houses away from the hospital. She was in Apapa at his office. And he called me, hey, yo, please, let me go there. Let me see if she's had a baby. I said, why can't you come here yourself? He said, hey, yo, you should know, I'm petrified. I have two boys. I'm praying for a girl. I said, why didn't you just take a simple x-ray to know whether you had a boy or a girl? He said, my wife refused to submit herself to that kind of medical experiment. So I was going back and forth to Finney and calling him and telling him, finally, that I had delivered a baby, and it was a baby girl. And I called Shey, I said, it's a girl. Shey screamed, now I have a child. How about Roti, me and Mide? He said, they are my boys. Well, Rolake is my child. You know. I said, an Oedipus complex, they call it. Sigmund Freud said, it's an Oedipus complex, something between father and daughter. Nobody understands it. But the relationship between a father and a daughter is so special. And that was what was between Yolake and his dad. So Yolake, she has not gone anywhere. It's just gone away. It's with you. He will guide you, he will be with you. On the day of your marriage, the spirit of your father shall walk you down the aisle. You see, our life is so interesting. But one of the people that has made me understand life is my own life. Because about 15 years ago, somebody who I loved very much, non-blood connected with me at all, a woman, she died at the age of 39. And I couldn't understand why somebody would die at the age of 39 when my own father died at 95. And I decided that I'm going to honor this person with the cerebral capacity that I had. Thank you. I would say, a writer. So I put my pen to paper to find out the reason why this young lady, Veronica Imadi, why she died. She had my blood. She's from Edo State. I'm pure Yoruba. But there's a friendship between me and this lady that is so exceedingly rare that if her husband was not a genuine human being and my real brother, she would have probably thought there was something going on between me and his wife. But this, my brother, trusted me so much, I knew there was nothing. And I sat down, I wrote a tribute to Veronica Imadi. I'm going to read part of what I wrote for Veronica. I can recite it off my head, but I would rather just look at the paper and say exactly what I wrote. This is what I said about death. I said, I suppose no one would dispute the fact that death is the controlling component part of our very existence as well as our non-existence. I went further to say, to live is to die. In Yoruba mythology and common sense native collection of poetry, our names depict events that has happened in our lives. And you will hear people say, a child is called Kokumo, Malomo, Ikuda Isi. They are all fallacy, untruth, baseless untruth put forward by mythology. Who is Kokumo? Have you ever seen anybody who has come to this life and does not go away? Who is Ikuda Isi? Have you ever seen anybody that death left alone and didn't die? If that was the case, where was my grandfather when I was born? Where was my great-grandfather? Where is yours? There's nothing like Kokumo, there's nothing like Ikuda Isi or Malomo. All of us, one by one, without exception, we have to go. But when you go, what are you leaving behind? What are you leaving behind? You see, when Sheye was born, he was born without nothing. And by the time we are going to bury him today, we shall bury him with nothing. But Sheye has left behind some chattels. And those chattels, I will glorify them today. Muralake, is one of the chattels that Sheye owned and left behind. Ayomide was one of those chattels. Rotimi was one of those chattels. But before Sheye died, Rotimi got married and brought a brand new daughter home to Sheye. Her name is Mojisola. She's one of those chattels that Sheye left behind. And of course, Sheye left behind Adedayo, his beloved wife. These are the treasures that Sheye left behind. We shall treasure his memory. We shall treasure the way he lived. You know, one thing I would like to say is what an English poet said many years ago. Edmund Spenser was one of England's most celebrated poets, but he died in 1557, so that's about the 16th century. He said, "We should be careful what we do, for he that once missed the road, the further he doth go forward, the further he doth stray." Don't miss the road. Don't miss the boat that Jesus Christ installed before he left. Don't leave miss the road that the Lord showed to us all in the scriptures. Let us be who we are. Let us be good. Let us just be nice. It costs nothing to be nice. It takes a whole lot of effort to be angry. And we saw that yesterday when one of our dear friends and one of Sheye's closest friends, Chief Okwebademosi, was stabbed to death by his cook, who has only worked with him for 72 hours. The devil took hold of him. He did what he had to do, and he punctured the heart of that young man and the heart of so many others, including my own. Please, do as much good as you can, and the Lord will ever make you rise. I want to thank this church that was sold to me many years ago by my late friend, Sheyola Lapo. He always speaks about this church. I'm thankful that I finally have the privilege to come to this church, to attend your service yesterday. More than that, to come here today to speak. My name is Dr. Adewale Adeyeyo. I am a gentle Muslim speaking in a Christian church. That is life. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Let's give the Lord a big round of applause for Dr. Adeyeyo. And thank you for your tribute. God bless you, sir. I'll read the biography of Pastor Olusheye Oladapo. It's on page 8 of our program, so we can read together. Pastor Olusheye Oladapo, born on Wednesday, the 5th of December, 1951, to Chief Samuel Akimbolaji, a member of the British Empire, and Madam Juliana Ibijoke Oladapo. Young Sheye attended the All Saints Primary School, Ogbokowo, Ondo, and had his secondary education in the same town at the famous St. Joseph's College, from where he graduated in 1968. After his higher school certificate at Ibadan Grammar School in 1970, Sheye went to the University of Lagos, Akoka, to earn a Bachelor of Science Honors degree in Business Administration in 1976. Sheye's first corporate experience was at Brian Monroe Limited, a British company where he reintroduced the Colgate Palmolive brand in the Nigerian market in the late 1970s. Sheye's initial foray into the world of business was quite successful, with the obtainment of the export license for cocoa products in the mid-80s. Following a very rewarding trading period using the company Stanmark Nigeria Limited which he co-founded with his childhood friend, Chief Okpe Bademosi. Share ventured into manufacturing and partnered with Cadbury Nigeria PLC to establish Stanmark Cocoa Processing Company. The plant designed by Cadbury Schweppes is located in Ondo State. He was chairman of Stanmark Assets Limited, which in partnership with Odua Investments Limited acquired the erstwhile National Bank of Nigeria. He led a team of investors and professionals to resurrect and develop the bank into a successful commercial bank that later merged with Wema Bank PLC during the 2005 bank consolidation exercise. Shehe Oladapo was an established businessman, an entrepreneur who had over 40 years of post-graduation experience spanning commodities trading and export, timber cultivation and export, cocoa cultivation and processing. He was also active in the manufacturing, marketing, and advertising sectors, while his business development skills, general management knowledge, and executive leadership traits were well owned. Shehe Oladapo was the chairman of Sage Strategic Logistics Company Limited, which specializes in midstream discharge of heavy-duty machinery, plants, and equipment. He was also chairman of Perez Homes Limited and a non-executive director of Argai Mortgage Bank. He was in acknowledgement of Shehe Oladapo's distinction in business development and for his giant strides in the world of business generally, that he became a recipient of the Merit Award for Entrepreneurial Excellence by the Ondo State Government. Shehe Oladapo's Christian faith was deepened by his 1983 marriage to his heartthrob, Dayo Oladapo Ni Egbeyemi, consequent upon a later conjugal decision to embark on the spiritual journey that culminated in Shehe being ordained a pastor at the Redeemed Christian Church of God. Not surprisingly, therefore, Shehe not only evangelized for Christianity, his faith showed through him in every facet of his life's engagement. A constant reader of the Word of God, the Bible, Shehe gave the impression of being inspired to seek spiritual understanding because of Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, which he often quoted, "My people perish for lack of knowledge." Shehe, the quintessential man of God and symbol of unostentatious Christianity, made sure that all the three products of his union with Dayo, Oluwarotimi, Ayomide, and Rolake, grew up in the fear of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I think the Lord deserves a big round of applause for a beautiful life, great testimony of Mr. Oladapo, Pastor Shehe Oladapo. God bless you. The choir has two songs for us, and they'll be taking us in two special songs. Pastor Shehe Oladapo was a great worshiper, and I'm sure that you'll be blessed as you listen. The first one is Tomorrow, and the second one is Ijoba Orun. Please listen and be blessed. Thank you.
Jesus said, "Here I stand. Won't you please let me in?" And you say, "I will tomorrow."
Jesus said, "I am He who supplies all your need." And you say, "I know tomorrow."
Tomorrow I'll give my life. Tomorrow I thought about today, but it's so much easier to say. Tomorrow, better.
please take my hands, and you say, I will tomorrow.
Jesus said, I am he who supplies all your need, and you say,
very well begin today.
put our hands together for Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the I Am that I Am, the Lord of Life. Give Him glory, give Him honor, give Him adoration. Praise the name of the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you. We bless your holy name. You have said that in every situation we should give you thanks. You know all things, and there's absolutely nothing that can happen to us behind your back. Father, you're still on the throne. You're a God that acts according to the counsel of your will. You're the sovereign Lord. We thank you, O Lord, because before this day came to be, you knew about it. So, Father, we thank you. We give you glory, we give you honor, we give you adoration. King of glory, in the next few minutes, please speak to us. Encourage us. Bless us. Comfort us. If need be, admonish us. At the end of it all, let lives be transformed. Let souls be saved. And bless us one more time. Take all the glory. Take all the honor. Take all the adoration. In Jesus' mighty name we are prayed. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'd like to commiserate with the family, my family also, our son, husband, father, brother, and pastor. Our dearly departed Pastor Olusheye Oladapo, who slept in the Lord on the 19th of October, 2018. Our Lord and Master Jesus Christ tells us in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 4, Matthew 5, 4, that blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And that gives me so much confidence that our weeping of today is just for a while. Joy and comfort will come sooner than later in Jesus' mighty name. Our prayer is that God will wipe away our tears and give us beauty for ashes, all of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for a spirit of heaviness in Jesus' mighty name. There are many words of comfort in the Bible. For example, God says in Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 2, Isaiah 43, 2, He says that, yeah, times will come when we pass through the waters, but He will be with us. And even when we go through the river shall not overflow us. And when we walk through the fire, we shall not be burnt. Our God is the God of the valley and God of the hills. A very present help in times of trouble. He is a husband to the widow and father to the fatherless. And my sister, Pastor Dio, wrote to me, Mojisola, Ayomide, Moralake, it is well with you. God will not abandon you in Jesus' mighty name. To the body of Christ, it is well with us. To the family, it is well with us in Jesus' mighty name. The Bible tells us and encourages us in Exodus chapter 7 and verse 2 and 4. Exodus 7, 2 and 4. It encourages us to come for this kind of service. For those of you that left your meetings and your workplace, you are in the place where God wants you to be. He says it's better to attend services like this than go for a party or anywhere where there's merriment. He says, because when we come here, we are confronted with the real issues of life. Knowing that death is a part of human experience. Unless there's rapture, every one of us, at our own time, at the appointed time, would have to meet with death. The Bible says that this kind of meeting, service, is called a wise man's school, in the hope
that haven't gone through the experience of yesterday and today and heard the things that we've heard, that we'll be able to wisen up and number our days and apply our hearts to wisdom. The Bible tells us also in Hebrews 9 and 27, it says, it is appointed unto man once to die. But after death, there is judgment. And that tells us that death is an appointment that we must all keep. And the Bible tells us clearly that there is no discharge on that day. Nobody has strength on the day of death. You can't fight it. Once it is time, it is time. And then we begin to understand that life is a loan. There are short-term loans, there are long-term loans. But the owner of the life, the owner of the loan, can recall that loan any time. He's called the Lord of life. There's a time to be born, and there is a time to die. But there's one thing that I know, that for the Christian, God says clearly in Exodus 22 and verse 23 to 26, Exodus 22, 23 to 26, it says, he himself will fulfill the number of your days. So everybody has a number, and God says he will fulfill it. Some die at 30, 33, 20, 60, 70, 90, 102, 110. So everybody has a number, but God says that that number that has been ascribed to us, he himself will fulfill it. So a Christian cannot die before his time. There's an appointed time. God says that not even the birds that are flying can fall down and die behind his back. He says the hairs on our heads, they are numbered. Each one numbered. But I'm sure he's not referring to the attachments. But the real hair on our heads are numbered. Colossians 3:3 says that your life as a Christian is hid with Christ in God. So if anyone wants to take your life, he has to pass through Christ into God and come back through God, through Christ, back. So we cannot die before our time if you are a Christian. God will fulfill the number of your days in Jesus' mighty name. In the story in Job chapter 1, even Satan had to ask for permission from God before he could afflict Job. So we know, as hard as it might seem, we know, we believe that our brother died at the appointed time. My prayer is that Lord God, the God that will serve, will fulfill the number of our days in Jesus' mighty name. Say better, amen. Amen. You know, we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we are not going to take anything back. But a lot of people are ignorant, and if you see the way they hold on to life, they want to go to heaven, yet they don't want to die. Indeed, we have accounts of the pharaohs asking that they be buried with their earthly possessions. And even in Nigeria, we have accounts of people that ask that their cars be turned into a coffin for them to be buried in. Such ignorance. There was a man that loved his possessions. Indeed, the god of Mammon had had him. He was controlled by the spirit of Mammon. So when he wanted to die, he told his wife, "Darling, I know you love me a lot." The man said, "Yes." He says, "Please, all my possessions, can you please bury me with them or bury them with me when I die?" you have always been an obedient wife. Will you do it? And the wife said, yes, darling, I will do it. Her friends were up in arms. How can you do it? How can you do it? How will you survive? He just said, just calm down. So on the day of death, on the day of the funeral, she valued all that he had and wrote a check in his name and put it in the coffin and said, darling, I have obeyed you. There is nothing we brought into this world and we'll go with nothing. We thank God that the cessation of life is not based on alphabetical order, or else people would have changed their names to Zebra, Zebulun, Zoo, Zigzag, or Zimbabwe. God will help us in Jesus' mighty name. But talking seriously, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 8, 2 Corinthians 5 and 8, it says, to be absent from the body is to be immediately present with the Lord. So we know as Christians that our father, our husband, is not here. He's immediately present with the Lord. He's not here. He has finished his course. And according to all the testimonies that we had, he kept the faith to the very end. And waiting for him is a crown of righteousness which God will give him on that day. At the Christian Wakekeeping yesterday, we had lots of good things said about our pastor, how he impacted lives, how he loved people, how he helped people, how he preached, how he was completely sold out unto God and the work of God. We heard about his love for his sweetheart, Pastor Dayo, for the children. He was an incurable giver. He supported every project that we had in church. His life was profitable to God. Indeed, as you saw from the slides, was a pastor in charge of the foundation class called New Believers Class. So as new Christians are coming, he would go there and teach them how to walk righteously. And also he was chairman of the City of David Movie Theater Projects. We have movies, and they were always having meetings. He was completely sold out, even unto God. And today, I just want to let out a secret, something that happened between us about 11 years ago. You know, about 11 years ago, I was transferred here with my sweetheart because the former pastor of this church, Pastor Escor Umfon of blessed memory, went to be with the Lord. And because of the circumstances, some members of this church who love their pastor, and it's understandable, could just not understand why the general overseer would post somebody from outside to come and be pastor over them. Of course, they forgot that we were all members coming from Freedom Hall, and we were only posted out in 1995 to go and set up a church called King's Court Chapel. So some of them wrote a letter, a protest letter to the general overseer, that we shouldn't come here. And they signed it. Some people left the church because they just couldn't take it in. But Pastor Sheye and Chief Chief, they wrote another letter to the general overseer and made a case for us that the general overseer should give us a chance because we were lovers, we were good people. A long page letter, and they canvassed it before the general overseer. They were in the minority. We held a lot of strategic meetings, but Pastor Sheye and Chief Chief stuck out their necks. It was the most unpopular thing they did. But we thank God, looking back 11 years after, everyone is united and we are working for God. People of God, We heard all that he did yesterday from people. It's in the tributes. We heard today also that he was a good man. A lot of people want good eulogies said concerning them at their funeral. You know, there was a story of twin boys, some guys. They were horrible people, womanizers, fraudsters, notorious liars. They terrorized the whole city. Then one of the brothers died. So the other brother came to the pastor and said, "Pastor, I know you have a building project. Please take $10,000 in support of your building project. But please, I want to slip in a request that on the day of the funeral, please tell the people that my brother was a good man." Such things leak out. So all the members of the congregation were in church, waiting to see how this pastor is going to say that this horrible man was a good man. The church was packed. And of course, at the time that the pastor was preaching, he pointed to the man lying in the casket and said, "You see this man? Horrible man, fraudster, womanizer. He terrorized the whole city. But compared to his brother that is sitting here, he was a good man." If you want things, good things said about you, then live a good life. It is because of the glorifying lives of born-again Christians like our brother, the kind of lives they live that glorify God, that caused the Bible to say in Psalm 116 and 15, Psalm 116 and 15 says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." When a believer like our brother goes home, God celebrates. That's why Christians are told to celebrate lives of those that you are sure made it to heaven. And we have an example in Acts chapter 7 and 55 to 60. Acts 7, 55 to 60. When Stephen was being stoned to death, God opened his eyes and he saw heaven. He saw Jesus Christ, who normally sits at the right hand of God, stand, giving him a standing ovation. And if Jesus Christ stood, then of course all the angels in heaven will be standing, clapping for the general that was coming home. So I just want you to indulge me as we just rise up and clap for this man of faith, this general of the Lord that served God, whose life
Hallelujah. Please be seated. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 13, 1 Thessalonians 4, 13, he says, "We should not sorrow like ignorant people concerning those that fall asleep in death, as if there is no hope beyond the grave." And in that scripture, he says two things. He says, because Jesus died and rose again with an empty tomb to show for it, he says, "All those who sleep in the Lord will on resurrection morning arise first." And it's going to be a glorious reunion. Loved ones, we see the loved ones. So, we know we'll see our brother again on resurrection morning. For the Christian, the grave is not the end. There is hope beyond the grave. Paul also says in that scripture in verse 13, he says, when a Christian dies, he's merely sleeping in the Lord. And we know that everyone that sleeps must wake up. We sleep and wake up. So if truly he's sleeping in the Lord, one day
he will wake up in Jesus' mighty name. You see, when Lazarus died and was buried 4 days, in John 11:11, Jesus said, "Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go to wake him up." And with one call of his name, Lazarus woke up. The same thing he said concerning Jairus' daughter in Mark 50:39, that they are sleeping. Even concerning Stephen, the Bible said he slept. And this thing that we're talking about of people sleeping, waking, has happened before in Jerusalem. The account is in Matthew 27:52-53. Matthew 27:52-53. When Jesus rose from the grave, the Bible says that all the graves in Israel of the saints were split open, and the saints that had died rose from the dead, and they walked the streets. They were around for 40 days going to see their loved ones. So it has happened before. We are confident that if you are a Christian, you die in the Lord, you will rise again. And that resurrection morning, there's going to be a glorious reunion in Jesus' mighty name. So we're confident that for a Christian, as David said in Psalm 23:4, death is but a shadow. It's a shadow, because what we do is just to sleep. My prayer is that God will speak to us today in Jesus' mighty name. But it's not the same for unbelievers, those that don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. There's a lesson we can learn from David in 2 Samuel 12:15. 2 Samuel 12:15. You know, he had a son through the adulterous relationship that he had with Bathsheba. And God told him that that son was going to die. David loved that son. He fasted, he prayed. The elders were trying to console him, but it was inconsolable. Then the child died. So in verse 20 of that scripture, the elders were afraid to tell him that the son had died, thinking that maybe he can kill himself. But when they told him, they were surprised that the attitude of David changed. He got up, he washed up, he went to church to worship God, and he came back and asked to eat pounded yam. The elders were surprised in verse 22 to 23. They said, how come now that he's dead, your attitude changed and you are no longer fasting and praying? And David told them, when he was sick, yes, I beseech God, maybe God will change his mind. But now that he is dead, I shall go to him. He shall not return to me. I'll see him again. I'll go to him. He will not return to me. So for him, being an innocent child, David was saying, good night. I'll see you in the morning. And for our pastor, we're saying, good night. We'll see you in the morning. But not so for unbelievers, those that have not surrendered their lives to Jesus Christ. Because in 2 Samuel 18:33, his son, a rebellious son called Absalom, when he died, the attitude of David was not the same. It changed. He said, my son, my son, my son, how I wish I died in your stead. He was inconsolable. Nobody could stop him, because he knew that concerning that unbeliever son that he had, it was not going to be good night, but goodbye. My prayer is that for us, when we go, it will be good nights and not goodbye. The Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. 1 John 1:8 says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. The only antidote for sin is the blood of Jesus. My prayer is that we will be ready when the Lord shall come. Amos 4:12. It says, prepare to meet your God. And the question today is that, are you prepared to meet God? It can happen anytime. It can happen suddenly. It can happen after some illness. He says, are you prepared to meet your God? And that's the question I want to leave us with. Or live with us. The Bible says it is appointed for man once to die. Then after that, judgment. 2 Corinthians 5:10, 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of things done in this body, whether good or bad. It's a judgment seat, not a mercy seat. When we're still alive, it's a mercy seat. Jesus is sitting on a mercy seat. He's merciful. But once we die, it becomes a judgment seat. And then we must all appear before him. So the questions I want to ask us, are you ready to meet him? They will review your case. It's a judgment seat. That what have you done in this life? I'm confident that our brother, our pastor, is going to be with the Lord. The voice of the people, the voice of God. He touched lives. His life was profitable to God. But how about you and I? When you meet him, will he say, welcome, well done, you good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your Lord? Or will he say, as was said in Matthew 25, 30 and 34, depart from me, you unprofitable servant, cast into outer darkness, an everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. You know, the Bible suggests that when we came into this world, that every one of us was given a task, a talent, an assignment, and that we must fulfill that assignment, our eternal purpose, our God-given destiny. That's what we've been talking about in church all throughout this year. Fulfilling the purpose of God in line with God's destiny. I'm confident that our brother did his own. So everybody has an assignment. God has given you an assignment which will determine whether you get a well done or depart from me. If you do all according to the plan of God, then it's going to be a well done. People of God, before we came to this world, God had given us what to do. There's an account in Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5. God said in Jeremiah 1, 5, said, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew you. Before you came forth out of the womb of your mother, I had already ordained you. You're not going to be a lawyer. You're not going to be. What I planned for you is to be a prophet to the nations. That was his assignment. If he did something else, he would have missed it. While it's okay to focus on goals and ambitions and pursuits like we all have, but eventually our goals and pursuits, they have to align with God's eternal predetermined purpose for our lives. Or else it will be a misspent life. Paul was a lawyer, a good lawyer. But what was written concerning him was that he was going to be an apostle and evangelist. If he went back to heaven and said, yes, I became a senior advocate of Nigeria, he would have missed it. He said, that's not what we sent you to do. We gave you talents. Yes, but this is your assignment. How about Luke? He was a doctor, but the plan of God was that his life will be profitable unto God. He was meant to be an apostle. Peter was a fisherman. But when he had an encounter with God, it was revealed to him that, look, 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 it's not fisherman of fishes, but you are ordained to be a fisher of men, an evangelist. Our general overseer, his ambition was to be the youngest vice chancellor of the University of Lagos. But thank God that midway, he had an encounter with God, and God revealed to him that no, that is not my assignment for you. My assignment for you is to be an evangelist, somebody that will lead a church and turn men's lives unto God. Today, to the glory of God, the Redeemed Christian Church of God is present in 196 nations of the world, and in Nigeria we have about 43,000 parishes. If he had been a vice chancellor, he would have been retired and gone back to his country, maybe to his home in Ifewara, and be, you know, something else but this. So it is important as a pastor for you to discover that assignment. What will you say when you stand before him? The judgment seat of Christ. For you to get it well done, your life must be profitable to God. Like a brother, you must be rich towards God, adding value to the things of the kingdom. We had yesterday as to how he added value to the things of the kingdom. Are you focused just on your pursuits, your career, your investments, and not giving enough attention unto God? There's a man called the rich fool in Luke 12:16-21. He lost focus. He was self-centered. It was all about him, his children, his investment. He didn't have time for God. And he ended up losing his life and going to hell. The Bible says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? What are your priorities? How are you spending your life? The Bible tells us in Revelation 14 and 12, that the only thing that follows us when we die are our good works. What are your good works? What are you doing with your life? The talents and the opportunities that God has given you. What kind of work will follow you? Nothing else will follow you, not your homes, your bank account, just your work. And we learned from Jesus that doing philanthropic work without a relationship with God will end up in a wasted and misspent life. What is important is the relationship with God. Are you born again? Matthew 7:21-23. It says, many will come on that day and say, Lord, Lord, I did this for you. I did wonderful works for you. I was a philanthropist. I even healed people. I cast out demons. But it says, they will tell them, depart from me. I never knew you. It's all about a relationship with God, which our pastor had. The plan of God for you and I is for us to know him personally. Jeremiah 9 and verse 24, the Amplified Version. The Bible says, don't boast about your wisdom. Yes, you are wise, wicked. Don't boast about your wealth. If you want to boast, boast in the fact that you understand and know me how? Personally and practically and directly. Do you know God? Have you heard his voice before? Do you know God? Or you're just playing church? But for you to discover your eternal purpose and your destiny, or for you to see the kingdom of God, or to enter the kingdom of God, you must have an encounter with Jesus. Even if you live to 100 years, one day it will end. 100 years is nothing compared to eternity in hell. For you to know your assignment, you must have an encounter with Jesus. All those that knew the assignment and made it to heaven, they had an encounter. And today, that encounter is ongoing. John 3:3-6 says, by Jesus, except a man be born again, he cannot see or enter the kingdom of God. Are you born again? That is the question for you to answer. When you die, are you sure where you will end up? Heaven or hell? Is your name in the register in heaven called the Book of Life? The end of our faith is the salvation of the souls for us to make heaven. That's 1 Peter 1:9. You know, There's a story in Luke 10 and 20. Luke 10 and 20. The disciples came to Jesus excited that were performing miracles, getting rid of demons. Jesus told them, yes, it's good, but notwithstanding in this, rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you. But if you want to rejoice, rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Is your name written in heaven? Is your name in the book of life? The Bible tells us in Revelation 20, 11 to 15, that our judgment, that judgment that we're talking about, is going to be based on whether your name is in that book, book of life, when you give your life to Jesus Christ, and your works, the book of works. So examine your life. How are you spending your life? If your name is not in the book of life, and you don't have good works to show even for it, you are going to hell. Eternity in hell. There are some people already there right now. May that not be your portion in Jesus' mighty name. People of God, Revelation 21 and 8. It says in Revelation 21 and 8, but the fearful, people going to hell, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the warmongers, the sorcerers, idolaters. Idolaters, what's an idol in this age? It's not a graven image. Some people, their idol is their phone. Even in church, during a funeral, they are checking WhatsApp. I went out, some people are using the phone here. You can't even, first thing you do in the morning, phone, your gadgets. It's an idol. An idol is anything that takes the place of God in your life. Anything that you put first before God. God is a jealous God. He says, seek me first. I want to be number one. I created you. Give me attention. Your idol can be your belly, food. It can be your career. You can't come to church because of the meeting. You play golf on Sunday. You walk the bridge on Sunday. Your children can be your idol. That's how Eli ended his life and the life of his lineage. Your spouse, material things can be your idol. God says idolaters are going to hell. All liars is there in that scripture. Who has not lied this year? Is there in black and white. All liars are going to hell. So if you know you have lied, it's better to run to Jesus. Surrender to him, plead the blood of Jesus. He gives you your spirit, and then you get the promptings. Even when you fall, you quickly go and say sorry. And you are reconnected. He says all these people shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone. And we need to know one bold statement in Acts chapter 4:12. Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given unto men whereby we must be saved. It is only Jesus. That's why you go to every tomb in the world. There is a bone there. But you go to the tomb of Jesus, which many of us have been to in Jerusalem. It's an empty tomb. He came from heaven. He rose from the dead. He says, I'm the way. Nobody else can take you to heaven unless he that came from heaven and says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other way. If you don't know your assignment, you don't know where you will end up. You are living dangerously. The Bible says in Psalm 49:20 says, a man in honor, they say sir to you, they bow down to you, woman. They respect you, they rise up when you come in. A man in honor that lacks understanding is like a beast. You know those dogs that cars kill on the road? You don't know where you came from. You don't know why you are. You don't know where you are going. Yet you are putting on clothes. You are driving a car, living in a house. You don't know where you'll end up. He says, you are no better than a dog, a beast that perishes. I didn't say it, the Bible said. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in this body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. It's a judgment seat. No mercy on that day. It is when you are still alive that you can have mercy. As I close, the story of a man who was walking on the road. He almost had an accident. There was a trailer coming, he didn't see the trailer. So one man just came and pulled him aside and saved him. He thanked the man and they said bye-bye. Then he went into wrong things. He became an armed robber. They caught him and they now charged him to court. When he entered that court, he saw the same man that saved him that day on the bench. Said, yes, I know him. He saved me then, he will save me now. The man said, yes, you know me. That day was a day of mercy. But today is a day of judgment. People of God, he that has ears, let him hear. On that day, Daniel 7, 9 to 10 says that the eyes of Jesus won't be like the Jesus we see. He says it will be like fire. His countenance will be like fire. No mercy. The Bible says he's angry with the sinner every day. Proverbs 29:1 says, the man who is often reproved, you come to something like this, you hear, give your life to Jesus Christ, and refuses to accept, will suddenly be destroyed and not have another chance. My prayer is that for you today, as you hear the word of God, you will not harden your heart. As I go to my seat, Revelation 19:9 says, as a marriage supper of the Lamb in heaven, we need to make it to that marriage supper. Jesus is going to marry the church. The church is the bride of Christ. And his bride must be spotless, without wrinkle. You can't do it unless God helps you. And how can you marry somebody that you didn't have a courtship with? If you don't know him here on earth, you can't know him in heaven. You must know him, have a relationship with him, court him here. Like a man will court a woman you are going to marry. Exchange pleasantries. Spend time together. Hear him and he hears you. I've heard him speak audibly, not once, not twice. He has a voice. He wants to get to know you personally. To help you out, to help us out. Those that will make it to heaven, you must have two birthdays. The day that your mother gave birth to you on earth. For a pastor, it was December 5, 1951. Then you must have another birthday, the day you are born again, born of the Spirit of God. His own was about 25 years ago. If you have two birthdays, if you walk righteously, you make it to heaven. But if it's just one birthday you have, you cannot point to the day you surrendered your life, you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you became born again. Nicodemus didn't understand. He said, does it mean I will enter my mother's womb and come back? He said, no. Big man like you don't understand. He said, surrender your life. So as all eyes are closed, are you here? Are you still struggling with sin? Or you just don't know why you are here? And it's dangerous to stand before that judgment stone. You'll be tongue-tied. You don't know what you're supposed to do. Your life is not profitable to God. You are not adding value. Yes, you have money, you have all kinds of things. But what matters most is, does God know you personally? Do you know him personally? Is your name written in that register in heaven? These are the end times. The Bible says that hell has enlarged its mouth because a lot of people are going down to hell. Not everyone will make it to heaven, but you can be an exception. So if you want to know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, like my brother, and be confident that whenever death comes, I'm confident that I'm making it to heaven. You can have that second birthday today, the 1st of November. It will be written down in heaven. We won't call you out. All I want you to do, it's just to lift up your hand and put it down. And you see, no sinner or confessing will make it to heaven.
And all have sinned, at least one sin that I know that all of us, most people, lie. And the Bible says liars are going to hell. If you say you have no sin, you are lying. So as all eyes are closed, what I want you to do is just lift up your hand and put it down. When you lift up your hand and put it down, the ushers will see you. Thank you, my brother. Thank you, my sister. Just lift it up and put it down. Thank you, my brother. Thank you. Thank you. There's one hand there. Just give them the card. You can either see us after or join a Bible-believing class. Okay? Anybody else? I've seen some people. Lift up your hands and put it down. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Thank you. There's somebody there. Amen. Lift it up and put it down. Lift it up and put it down. Second birthday, registration time in heaven. And if you are born again and you are in sin, you better recommit your life. Because when he comes and he catches you in sin, it's going to be another story. So for those that are collecting cards, just repeat after me quietly. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you right now. I know I'm a sinner. Please forgive me my sins. With my heart, I believe that it's because of me that you came to this world. With my mouth, I confess that Jesus, you are the Lord of my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Please write my name in the book of life and make me brand new. If you said that prayer, I congratulate you on your new birth. God bless you, and I will see you through in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Congratulations for all those that dedicated and rededicated their lives to Jesus. Please help us to fill the cards and give them back to the ushers, and we'll be in touch with you. And you can also write your prayer request there as well, if you have one, and we'll be praying along with you. And very soon you will start to see answers to many of your requests in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. We'd like to invite the regional elder for Redeemed Christian Church of God, Region 20, Pastor Tokunbo Adesanya, to pray for the family. Let's clap unto the Lord as Pastor Adesanya comes.
Can the immediate family please stand? Precisely 2 weeks today, exactly 2 weeks, we had a walk in our estate, and I met with my brother. At the end of the discussion, he said, I will see you. He must be laughing, because I can see him, his spirit is seeing me. Of all the testimonies that were given, the thing that stood out is nobility. I speak to the children. Nobility. Nobility is rare. Nobility belongs to the kingly homes. Not everybody can be kings or princes. Your father was noble. The country we live in today, when they say to you, good afternoon, you need to open the window and be sure that it's not floodlight. And your father said, yes, you can take it to the bank. There's a great task ahead of you. I'm not saying this to frighten you. I'm saying this for you to know the heritage that you have acquired. So, my children, I say to you, rejoice. For my sister Dio, you'll be looking at projects. You'll be looking at things that he did and you commanded as of right. And you are asking at this moment, who is going to do this? God is saying to you, fear not. He says, fear not, for I am your husband. Shall we pray? My Father, my God, I bless you for the life of your son, Pastor Sheye Oladapo. Thank you for the life he lived that is to your glory. As he has ended this life, Lord, receive him in glory. In the name of Jesus. Father, behold the family he has left behind. Thank you, Lord, for your daughter. Your word never fails. May your word never fail in the life of your daughter, in the name of Jesus. Your word says she should fear not. And you say she will not remember the days of widowhood. My Lord and my God, may widowhood not be her definition. In the name of Jesus. Father, be strength to her. Be cover to her. Be a support to her. Defend her on all fronts. In the name of Jesus, prosper the works of her hands. Grant her joy. Grant her peace. In the name of Jesus. Henceforth, O God, may celebration come into her home. Celebration of marriages. Celebration of grandchildren. In the name of Jesus. Defend her, O God. Smile upon her, O God. Let your goodness, your mercy and loving kindness be her portion for the rest of her days on earth in the name of Jesus. For you children, you would ask, if our father had been good, why should he go that early? The Lord is saying to you, henceforth, the sun will not give you light, nor the moon, but he will be your light. He will be your portion in the name of Jesus. The answer to your question is, I have been young. Now I am old. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their children beg bread. You will never beg bread in the name of Jesus. As you knock at doors, multiples of doors will open unto you in the name of Jesus. God will send helpers to you in the name of Jesus. You will know favor before God. You will know favor before men. In the name of Jesus. Your father was great. You will be greater in the name of Jesus. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord watch over you. May the Lord smile upon you. May he be gracious unto you. Now and always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
Praise the name of the Lord. We just listened to the following announcements. This funeral service has been conducted, as you have seen, by the City of David of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, where the love of God reigns and dreams come true, where legends are born and tomorrow's history is being experienced today. There will be a private interment after this service. It has to be private just for the immediate family, as requested by the family. I would like to acknowledge the presence of His Excellency, Mr. Olusegun Mimiko, the former governor of Ondo State. I will also acknowledge the presence again of His Excellency, Otumba Benga Daniel, the former governor of Ogun State. You're welcome, very welcome, sir. I will also want to acknowledge all dignitaries in the house and also all pastors, all provincial pastors, regional pastor, our pastor, of course, once again, Pastor Idu Iyomade, and also all well wishes and loved ones that have come to commiserate with the Oladapo family. I'm praying that the Almighty God will bless you, keep you, and cause His face to shine upon you in Jesus' name. We would like to inform you of our services here in the City of David, at the City of David. We meet here every Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. for what we call a Digging for Gold service. And on Thursday, we meet here at 6:30 p.m. for Power, Praise, and Pentecost service. And on Friday, we meet here for 1 hour of praise, which has been tagged His Lord Praise Hour. And of course, on Sundays, we meet here for two services at 7:30 in the morning for the sunrise service and 10:30 in the morning for the sunshine service. But this Sunday is going to be a Thanksgiving service. It will just be one service here at the City of David. The reception, of course, will be at it's called D-Venue, that's at Landmark Road, Victoria Island, which is basically the Water Corporation Road. That's where the reception will be after the private internment. It's my prayer once again that the Almighty God will strengthen the entire family, our mommy, our mother, Mrs. Dayo Oladapo, and also your children. God is your strength. He will be with you. He will surround you continually with His glory. You will never be confounded, and you will never be ashamed. In Jesus' name. To lead us in the benediction for this service, I will invite the pastor in charge of province, PICP Province 37, Pastor Femi Obaweya. You're very welcome, sir.
Shall we bow our heads even as we pray? God of all comfort, we thank you. Thank you because you do not leave us comfortless. Indeed, you say you will send to us the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your grace that has seen this family through these past days. Thank you for your grace that is available for the church at large. Thank you because we know that even the days ahead, as we commit them into your hands, you are able to keep them. As we are about to enter the last phase of this ceremony, which is to formally inter the body of our brother. We pray for your grace. We pray for your comfort. We pray for your strength. Your word says, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. And so, Lord God Almighty, we are confident that the days ahead, grace will be available. Uphold all who mourn right now and grant them peace. And so we declare over you all, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord protect you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you. And may the Prince of Peace, that gives peace that no man can understand, bequeath you with that peace. And let that peace be an anchor for your lives and the days ahead. In Jesus' precious name, we have prayed.
Praise the Lord. We'll be taking the Alleluia chorus standing, and immediately after the chorus, we'll go into a recessional hymn, the choir, with the choir. And please, as we take the recessional hymn, we'll allow the pastors to go out first, and then, of course, the family and the casket as well. And then we'll bring the service to a close. Please let's rise for the Alleluia chorus. Thank you.
Oh,